it's fine building jumbo planes or taking a ride on a cosmic train. Switch on summer from a slot machine. Just get what you want if you want, as you can get anything. I know we've come a long way, we're changing day to day. But tell me.
Hi, welcome to Here and There. I'm Beryl Bernay Kusowska. We're very lucky today. We have a very unique guest. So I'm lucky and you are too. We're going to learn a lot. She's going to share some of her significant thoughts, some of her significant knowledge. Let's meet her right now. Let's meet Denise Lassaw.
Okay.
Who is a mask maker, among other things. And there she is, wearing one of her beautiful masks. Denise, would you take it off and tell us about it? Right.
Okay.
Isn't that lovely? Tell us about this mask.
I made that one as a present for my mother. It's mm-hmm. a spring goddess mask.
With flowers and jewels. Here, you hold it. With flowers and jewels, and it's made of paper mache and any other materials that inspired you, right?
Right.
All right. We're going to find out, all of us will find out more about Denise, because she's got a truly unique story.
Is it sharp enough?
Suppose we start with, how you got to making masks, and you tell it in whatever sequence you want to, all right?
Okay, well, actually, when I was in junior high school, you know, I made some masks. I've always mm-hmm. worked with clay and welding, all different kinds of materials. And I was torn between doing sculpture, weaving, beadwork, so many different things that interested me. Mm-hmm. And there's different levels of making the masks, so there's different stories. On one level, it was seemed like the right thing to do, to combine all the beads and fabric and mm-hmm. welding and everything else together.
Were you aware, I'm sorry, I just want to interrupt you for one thing. Were you aware when you started making masks in high school that mask making is in so many cultures around
oh, yes.
the world? You were already.
Yes, because I had been in New Mexico when I was small and seen mm-hmm. Kachina dances and I mm-hmm. visited museums mm-hmm. all the time, so I knew about masks. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, it seemed a way to put all the things that I love together mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and yet in a way cutting down on the amount of things that I was doing. I wouldn't have to be a weaver and a potter and a bead worker and.
A choice that was all
right.
Inclusive.
I wouldn't have to throw away mm-hmm. any of my toys. I could mm-hmm. combine them all.
Mm-hmm. And then tell us a little bit about your life. I mean, we met in East Hampton, and I know originally you were from Manhattan, but now you live in Alaska mm-hmm. and have lived there for several years.
Since 17.
17 years, that's a long time. It's much more than several. And tell us about how you got there and what you're doing there and more. I've seen many of your masks and I love them very much, and they all have very special character. And people always associate, not always, but in many cultures, people associate masks with magic and mystical mm-hmm. ideas and dreams, and tell us about that part of your life, please.
Okay, well, I went to Alaska originally from New Mexico. I was living there. I had lived in a teepee for 2 years, and I was living on a commune that I helped start, and I had a lot of really beautiful experiences in the teepee, feeling the sky, knowing when certain stars rose in the sky. I wake up. I had a dream once that said strange things happen at the eclipse of the moon, and And I woke up, and sure enough, the moon was just going into eclipse. And so I wanted to live.
And you hadn't known that. You hadn't known
I didn't read newspapers. Mm-hmm. I didn't have a radio, anything. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to live by myself. I wanted to be a hermit in the mountains. I was quite interested in Tibetan things, and so I, you know, read a lot about that, and whatever I was interested in, I studied.
And not knowing that many years later you were going to marry a Tibetan.
Yeah, I had no idea. It was the furthest possibility away, you know.
Go ahead.
So I was living in New Mexico, and I was planting the garden one day. It was very hot. And I went in the house for a drink of water, and then I lay down and took a nap. And I had this beautiful dream, and in the dream, a whole bluebird wing, it wasn't a bluebird, it was a blue feather wing with red and yellow, it's actually a macaw, but I didn't know that in the dream. This whole wing was given to me, and it had rainbows on it, and it was just gorgeous, and I felt so happy when I received the wing. And then I woke up and went about my business, and a couple of days later I was visiting some people in Albuquerque, about, you know, 150 miles away, and this guy gave me this beautiful blue feather with red and yellow on the underside.
My goodness.
It was a macaw feather, and he had found it on a barren hillside in California. He'd found a whole wing, and suddenly it occurred to him that he should give it away. So he did, and he took each feather off and gave it to different people.
So then, your dream, it was your dream, which was fantasy, becoming reality.
Right, and it's a long, complex story, and it doesn't have too much to do with mask making, but I just held on to this feather, mm-hmm. and I felt this was something very magical, and I never made decisions and plans exactly. I would do what my intuition told me. If it says go this way, go that way, I do it. Mm-hmm. So at that time especially, I really followed my intuition. I had nothing to lose, you know. So I had met these guys, and we were thinking about maybe get some land or goats and houses and mm-hmm. whatnot, mm-hmm. and how to make money. So all of a sudden I heard myself say, let's go to Alaska. And I had a VW bus, and we set off. They got as far as California. I went to Sausalito, actually. Uh-huh. I went up to Northern California, where I had other friends. I was just going to make money to go back to New Mexico. I ended up going all the way to Alaska, meeting people who introduced me to other people who lived in the woods, who it turned out I knew from years ago in Colorado.
Who lived in the woods in Alaska.
And so they found me a little cabin, and I spent 2 years living alone in the woods.
Oh my, that's not
and
easy.
It was very beautiful, you know, it was very cold, sometimes mm-hmm. 60 below for many weeks. And I had a dog, so mm-hmm. I did have company, mm-hmm. and I cut wood, I melted snow for water, and I just lived alone. And of course sometimes, you know, I was very, very lonely.
And frightening, and, not frightening.
Oh, and frightened, right. too, yes, mm-hmm. because there were grizzly bears in the woods, mm-hmm. and there were moose around, and you never know about people.
But
and
you're a very brave person, I think.
Not
maybe,
really,
oh,
no.
Oh, yes, you I are. I think a lot of people are frightened, and they don't realize that people who have the most courage are sometimes the people who are most frightened, but they're the ones who do what they have to do. And in this case, you had to do that somehow for yourself.
Yeah, it's something I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And when I used to hitchhike cross country, I would pinch myself and I'd say, are you okay right now? Oh, it's a beautiful day. I'm okay right now, so this is fine. So I was scared to death, but one step at a time, then you're not scared, you know, you're all right now, it's okay. So I lived for the moment. Mm-hmm. But I had some experiences when I was in the bush, and I lived in two different places, one near Delta Junction, and then another down near the Copper River, which was much colder, more miserable place, because the cabin wasn't very good. Mm-hmm. And while I was staying there, this man that I had just met, he was someone who lived a few miles away, mm-hmm. shot a bear. Mm-hmm. And he knew that I made jewelry, I made different things. Mm-hmm. He shot the bear to have a claw necklace.
Oh, dear.
And I was so disgusted, you know. I hate this. Why anyone would want to shoot a bear anyway?
Killing for decoration.
It's horrible. He didn't even want the meat. So he brought me the bear, mm-hmm. the whole bear. He didn't even gut it or anything, which ruined the meat. And he brought it to me in the late afternoon, and I skinned the bear. And here was, you know, as when you take the clothes, the skin off the bear, it's mm-hmm. like this human being. And it was something tremendous, mm-hmm. strange, eerie feeling to have this naked bear there. And I used the meat for some dogs, mm-hmm. and also we used some of it that was good. Mm-hmm. And I did make him a necklace, but I made it with horrible plastic beads in between, and mm-hmm. he loved it. He was so silly that he didn't know that I was insulting him. Then I took the skin and I stretched it and I worked it, and mm-hmm. I had this bear smell all over me because I was kneeling on the bear skin. It was a black bear. And I salted it down anyway, you know, cleaned it up real well, and I used it as a rug in my cabin. Mm-hmm. And this has to do with, I had always been interested in shamanism. I was mm-hmm. finding the shaman inside
had
me.
Had you been interested even before you went to New Mexico and knew about
yeah,
the Indians,
yeah, I always
Native
had
Americans?
Been. Yeah. And I was sort of jealous of American Indians mm-hmm. because they seemed to be in contact with their recent shamanistic past. Mm-hmm. But I decided that I had it also. It's just a matter of reaching in inside and finding what was already there. Mm-hmm. So I had the bear skin on the floor, mm-hmm. and it was summer, and I was running around outside barefoot, and it was raining. Mm-hmm. And I walked into the cabin for something. I walked straight over to the corner that was the kitchen. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, I had this powerful feeling that I said, someone is following me. And I turned around, and I saw wet footprints on the floor right behind me. And I went, bear prints. And then I realized that they were my own footprints mm-hmm. on the floor. And I think it was starting in from there that I realized that, you know, I was sort of, I had eaten this bear, I had shared his skin. I, in a way, was becoming the bear also.
Some of his spirit had entered you,
yeah.
which is the way
and
it is.
Then I thought of making masks.
With that kind of openness, if you've been that close to an animal or a person mm-hmm. who has died, some of the spirit enters you in many cultures.
Yeah.
And that's what had happened. What about his head? Was his head there also?
I mean, well, just the part I skinned out, just the skin.
So that was there some relationship between his head or the skull, and you're going back to making masks?
I don't, not particularly. It was the mm-hmm. spirit, not the
spirit
head.
The
head was just a head, just blood and meat. And
was one of the first masks you made the bear?
Yes.
Really?
Yes, it was.
Yes.
And I don't have a slide of that one.
I have seen, we're going to see some slides of Denise's masks in a moment, but I have seen one of her masks, which is it the bear that opens up?
That's a different bear.
Where there's a mask and it opens up and there is the person inside, the spirit of this mask. It's a wonderful mask. It's one of the first ones of hers I saw. Now we're going to see some of her other masks as soon as we can.
Are we ready to see?
And had you made masks, here we are. Now this is, tell
this
us
is
about
a salmon
it.
Mask. And it's wearable, it's very large, it's as large as a king salmon, and you look out of the mouth.
Well, that's true in a lot of African masks, and Eskimo mm-hmm. masks too, I think, I'm not sure.
And this is a feathered
oh, that's wonderful.
Mask I made for a lawyer in Anchorage. That's President Reagan, I used him in an anti-nuclear protest play in the park. This is a de Kooning woman mask. I gave that to de Kooning for a present one Christmas.
Oh my.
This is a mask from I've been working for theaters in Anchorage
That's
making
a frightening
things.
One.
And this is for Beauty and the Beast. It's
uh-huh.
the Beast.
Uh-huh.
This is a mask that I did recently. This
I like
in
that
its unfinished
much.
State.
Oh, but the
it's
expression
a, about
is wonderful.
4 foot diameter. It was for a play in Anchorage that was called The Dragon.
4 foot in diameter?
Yeah.
My.
And that's finished. I actually like it unfinished better. And
I do too, because it had a sadness, and in
yeah.
the finished painted one you don't get the depth of the character.
And this one looks a little bit Eskimo influence, and it's supposed to be. That's
uh-huh.
what the director of the play
yes,
wanted.
I had seen ivory carvings done
mm-hmm.
by Eskimo people with hands coming out and feet and
right.
little symbols coming out of them, and it was similar to
yeah,
this
it's very
huge
beautiful.
One. Wonderful.
I try to absorb, you know, I look at masks from all over the world
mm-hmm.
and I try to absorb things from them but
mm-hmm.
not to copy them directly
mm-hmm.
and that's the most I ever did a copy.
And then I know that you've used your mask making and some of a lot of your thinking and feeling about it to communicate to children.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about teaching and tell us
okay.
about teaching in Alaska.
Well, some years ago, I would say 1982, I think,
mm-hmm.
I had a friend who taught puppets in the bush. Now,
mm-hmm.
puppets are something else that I've
mm-hmm.
always been interested in.
Me too.
And so she said, well, gee, you know, why don't you teach mask making or something? And so
mm-hmm.
I applied to the Artists in the Schools program.
Let's see some of those slides about your teaching in the bush.
Okay.
Yeah?
Yeah, let's do that. This is I go out into remote areas of Alaska, and I'll stay for a week or 2 weeks teaching puppets or mask making or both,
mm-hmm.
and usually to the whole school.
Mm-hmm.
And I fly in a lot of little planes. We can see the next slide. This is Kivalina, which is it's one of my favorite places that I've ever been. It's 150 miles north. West of Kotzebue on the Chukchi Sea. Next. And I walked out onto the sea. Teaching is a way of going out and seeing Alaska and
what
exploring.
Is what is that in the center?
It's a man on a snow machine who is going out to the place where they're whaling. And this is on the frozen sea. And just maybe 100 miles, or I'm not sure exactly how many, but probably no more than 100 miles away is the coast of Siberia.
And then the schools where you're teaching?
In the village.
How big is the village about?
This village was about 250 people.
And it's an Eskimo village?
Yes.
Right.
Inuit. These are they're whale ribs on the beach next to the village, and it's a spirit door to welcome the spirits into the village.
Oh my.
And this is just more ice. I was fascinated. I'm always fascinated by water and ice, and this is just walking out in the pressure ridges way out in the Chukchi Sea. Next. That's more of the same. I have hundreds of slides.
And this?
This is a picture of me. It's rather dark, but it was a little bit past real sunset. I'm sitting on the ice of the Bering Sea in another place. And so I think that's the end of those of the slides in that group.
All right. I think I don't know. I'm going to ask you now. I know we're going to see some of the artwork that the
yeah.
children have done. Children whom you've inspired and taught how to make things. And I want to talk a little bit more about your spiritualism and some more of what you've learned so that we can learn a little bit from you. So would it be better to show the artwork of the children before or
yeah,
after?
Yeah, we could just
before,
look at those
let's go
right
on.
Away.
Let's go on and see the artwork
yeah.
of some of the children that Denise has taught.
Tell us about it as we go.
Okay, this is a high school student in Kivalina who's making a... I work in paper mache, first modeling in clay, then we work in paper mache, then they use paint, feathers. You can skip to the next slide. Next, yeah. And we do puppets.
Oh, those are wonderful. Had they particular animals in mind, or are they fantasy animals?
I never ask. Okay. I show them slides of masks and puppets from all over the world, and then I just work on the sculptural part of it, and mm-hmm. whatever they want to make, mm-hmm. they can make.
Mm-hmm. Do you speak their language?
No, I don't.
Mm-hmm. You teach them in English and just show
them?
Yeah,
they all speak English in school.
Uh-huh. What is this beautiful one?
This is a puppet with wild hair that comes out.
Uh-huh. And he's so pleased with it.
Colors don't look like. This is in Anchorage at the Visual Arts Center where I work. We have an Art Saturday program. And these are some of the slides. We can just go in.
Are the children performing slides, or are they just showing
their
masks?
No, they're just wearing their masks outside so I can take slides.
The one on the left with the pop
this
eyes.
This was really
and the
nice. I had
wonderful.
Four Saturdays of teaching and only 16 kids, and it was very relaxed. And everybody was very motivated.
And they made these during the four sessions?
Yeah.
Very good. And these?
Yeah, this is all part of the
these
same.
These are people masks. And?
Well, they're people, kids love monsters, and so you get lots of different types of monsters.
Where they get rid of a lot of their feelings about people and that they don't like and things they're afraid of, and what a good way to do it.
Yeah, or what they would like to be, you know.
Okay.
That's it.
Yeah. All right. Well, I think that now our audience is probably beginning to understand why you're here and why you're one of my favorite people to know, not just to be guests on this program. So I think tell us more about the spiritual side of your life, which is really apparently most of your life.
I always tried to follow just my intuitive feeling of what was right, and I grew up influenced by Buddhism, even I think of the poems of Walt Whitman. Mm-hmm. Especially, you know, the Open Road poem is the favorite one. And I think they meant more to me when I was younger, you know. But being part of the world, the whole planet as one body, one mind, one kind of creature, that we are all part of it.
Is that a consciousness?
Not separate from it in any way, you know. Just an outgrowth, just like flowers. Mm-hmm. Where all the flowers are connected.
Mm-hmm. Is that a consciousness that you try to teach children and do adults listen? Because more and more in our culture, adults are feeling somehow that they're missing something that's very valuable. A lot of what they're missing is what you're talking about.
I don't teach directly. In schools, I try to be very careful to be rather neutral because some people may have different ideas. Mm-hmm. But as I'm teaching the mask making, the ideas come through that.
Of course.
And so people will get it without me saying anything. And if I'm teaching grown-ups, which I do occasionally, and that's fun because you don't have to tell them to be quiet, and you can drink coffee and talk, and they understand the first couple of times you tell them. I like teaching grown-ups. Then you can talk about philosophy behind things. And I would be very interested in doing a workshop with someone who's trained in psychology and dream work and get people to do mask from their dreams, desires,
Why don't you even do it without somebody who's trained in psychology?
I guess I probably could.
It would be an interesting workshop to do in any case.
Yeah, it's a matter of being organized to do it.
And having people be free enough to go with their impulses and what they're making, where maybe if they were thinking, they couldn't do that. But if you're making something, it's like
when I'm painting, I frequently don't know what's going to come out.
Oh, yeah.
And when you're making a mask, I'm sure you often don't know how it's
going to turn out. No, I usually don't. I don't make drawings beforehand. Mm-hmm. I may have a feeling, I may see a shape or a color, something, you know, some feeling, and I want to catch that feeling. Mm-hmm. Or a lot of times, if I see animals, it's I made a sloth mask, and it's a certain way, the smile. He had a wonderful smile, and I wanted to catch that. I didn't really want to reproduce the sloth, but just catch that feeling, you know.
The feeling in the character of that animal.
Yeah.
Animals are very important to you, aren't
they? I love animals very much. Mm-hmm. I feel that they're, you know, should have as many rights and should have someone who speaks for them. Just as we worry about people all the time, and who are we human beings, take over the planet and ruin everything and blow ourselves up and everybody else. I mean, trees, mountains, rivers, everybody should have the right to say, stop making nuclear weapons, say, that's it.
Hear, hear.
I don't want to, everybody should live together very peacefully.
Including as many animals as possible.
Everybody, meaning animals, human beings.
And then I liked what you said too about the flowers. The flowers. Have you studied anthropology? I've studied.
Yeah,
you
quite
have.
A bit.
Well, and in some cultures, many cultures, flowers are so important because flowers belong to everybody. I once worked with a company of Balinese dancers, and I was the narrator, and I would be given flowers at the end, and all the people, the dancers, would all come to take the flowers, because flowers don't belong to one person.
Right.
They belong to everybody, like the sky and the water. Tell us more about that in what you started to say before about that.
The Balinese have wonderful mask-making traditions, and I would love to go there and study with them. When they carve a mask, they then have to have ceremonies. You can't just make a mask and put it on and do a dance. You have to have a ceremony to give it its spirit. And you also have to do meditation or some kind of communing with that spirit before you can wear it.
And when one wears the mask, the spirit of the mask
becomes
personage.
You are it.
You become that.
Yeah.
You become that spirit that takes over. And when you take off the mask, very many times people go in trance, becoming the spirit.
And that's really, you know, shaman trips there.
There's many cultures. In New Guinea also, and in New Zealand.
And Tibetan.
And Tibetan
mask-making
too, really, also. And I'm going to ask you when we're closing the program, which is going to be almost right now, I'm going to ask you to please put this mask on again.
Okay.
And this is a very beautiful mask. Before you do, Denise is a beautiful person, and I want to thank her on your behalf and on my behalf for being here today with us and for sharing some of that. Is there any thought that you want to close with that you think might help for people to lean in a direction that might help them to free themselves a little bit, be able to share some if you're not calling it courage, but some of your ability to go with your intuition sometimes?
Well, I think life is about trying to be happy. And Bucky Fuller said something, this is not exact quote, but it was, try to remember what it was you wanted to do before people told you you had to make a living. And I've always tried to live by what it was that I wanted to do, regardless of whether it made a living or not. Which is difficult life, but it's worth it.
Good. And that's it for today. And I want to thank Denise again. I want to thank you for being here. And we really were very lucky that she was with us. I hope you come back. She's on her way to Alaska, but we hope to see her again. Thank you. I'm Beryl Bernay Kosofskaya. Come back next week for Here and There. As we go here and there.
jumbo plane, taking a ride on a cosmic train. Switch on summer from a slot machine. Just get what you want if you want, 'cause you can get anything. I know we've come a long way, we're changing day to day. But tell me, where do the children play? And you make them long, and you make them tough.